Let's check in with the city of Seattle. This is Cal Anderson Park, where they seem to be building another little autonomous zone. This is what happens when far-left lunacy takes over a city. Seattle's city council has 9 members. 8 are Democrats and 1 is from the socialist alternative. 0 independents, 0 Republicans, full-blown lunacy. And talking about full-blown lunacy, let's not forget LA, where the progressive district attorney, George Gascon, will not prosecute certain crimes. His do not prosecute list includes trespassing, disturbing the peace, driving without a licence, driving with a suspended licence, prostitution, drug possession, being under the influence of a controlled substance, public intoxication, resisting arrest, and making criminal threats. Yep, the DA has issued a directive that those crimes should be declined for prosecution. No wonder so many people are fleeing California. I spoke to one of the renegades of the intellectual dark web, the host of the Rubin Report and proud Californian Dave Rubin earlier today, about the sorry state of California and much more. Dave Rubin, why is California such an unholy mess?
Rita, first off, it's good to be with you. I wish we were somewhere on the beach in Australia. Instead, I'm here in Los Angeles, where we do have beaches, but I'm just not sure we're allowed to go to them. I mean, look, our governor, Gavin Newsom, he is the former mayor of San Francisco. And for your audience in Australia that's not that familiar with San Francisco, I mean, this is the hub of big tech, Silicon Valley. He absolutely ruined San Francisco. And how do you ruin these places? You increase taxes, you make the cost of living sky high, thus homelessness starts increasing, drug use starts increasing, and everything else that big government policies do. And then what happens in the progressive world? Well, you fail up. You go from being mayor of a city you destroyed, San Francisco, and you become governor of California. So right now, as I do this show from, this is my office in my house, we are technically not allowed to have other people that we don't live with in our homes. Our mayor here, Eric Garcetti, doesn't want us walking our dogs or getting outside. I mean, every restaurant, even though California, Southern California, is absolutely beautiful. It's like a beautiful day in Australia. The weather is perfect and great, and people want to be outside. We can't have indoor dining, and now we can't even have outdoor dining. And watching such a spectacular place be destroyed is pretty depressing.
Well, we are seeing a lot of Californians, including some high-profile individuals like Elon Musk and Joe Rogan, flee the state for Texas and other parts of the country. But why do Californians leaving the leftist utopia keep voting for the very same policies that wreck the state they're fleeing? We're seeing parts of Texas turn Democrat.
Yeah, you know, it's very strange. And I talk to a lot of people in California about this. They seem to be unable to make the connection between voting for Democrats, which California is basically in totality a Democrat-run state. There are, in effect, no Republicans anywhere, little tiny little pockets. But these people that then leave because of the high taxes, because of the overregulation, because of the lockdowns and the crushing effect that all of that has on small business, they go to Texas and then they go to these other places, Utah and Colorado, and then they help turn these places blue. They seem to be unable to make the connection between their poor voting choices for bad progressive Democratic candidates and then the very reasons that they're leaving these states. And I think Texas could be in a lot of trouble because, you know, when Ted Cruz, Senator Ted Cruz, who's a Republican, obviously, when he won his last Senate battle against Beto O'Rourke, it was pretty close. It was within a couple points. Mm. And if you start importing all of these people, and then they don't make the connection that, oh, I'm fleeing the bad policies that I voted in, well, then Texas could turn blue. And if Texas turns blue, America is a very, very different country. So I think all of these red states that are welcoming all of the blue people, I mean, that's the beauty of America. You can choose what state you want to live in, and you can use your foot vote and hopefully live in a place that's a little more in line with the way you want to live. But I think the red states have to sort of have a little bit of caution here and go, well, you know, it's nice that Oracle's coming here. It's nice that, you know, Joe Rogan's coming here. But if they're going to bring the bad ideas, well, then we got a problem.
Well, yeah, you've already got California, New York, which are just Democrat heartland. Those electoral college votes, you know, always are going to go for the Democrat nominee. And then if you turn Texas and Florida blue, then that's pretty much a done deal. You can sort of stop worrying about presidential elections.
Yeah, I mean, I don't even want to think about it at some level, but you are right. Of course, if you lost Texas and Florida, you know, Texas has been solidly red for a long time. But as I said, we're seeing some of the change around that. Florida, I think, will continue to stay red because so many people now, for some reason, people from New York that flee down south, they go down to Florida. They seem to be able to make the connection a little bit better about, oh, yes, I'm fleeing the high taxes. For some reason, the California people seem unable to make that connection. So I think Florida will be more okay. Texas has a problem. But look, this is the beauty and the danger of the American system. The beauty of the American system, as I said, is you can move to different states. We are the United States of America. And if you don't like what's happening in New York, you can move to Texas. If you don't like what's happening in Arizona, you know, you can move to Florida, whatever it might be. That's a beautiful thing at some level. And then also, because we are the United States, it makes it very hard to manage all of these differing ideas. I don't know any country that's doing it better than us, but it doesn't mean that it's easy.
Now, well, right now, California, you mentioned the strict lockdown there, devastating small businesses, but not everybody is suffering. There are big businesses doing very nicely indeed, from Costco to Amazon. In fact, Jeff Bezos's wealth, is the Amazon owner, has increased by over $90 billion during the pandemic. Are these COVID restrictions disproportionately impacting small businesses?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's disproportionate in that it's complete devastation to small businesses. It is literally impossible. If you're a restaurateur, if you own a restaurant, and you know, Rita, how difficult it is to own a restaurant. I mean, something like in America, something like 90% of restaurants fail in the first year in good times, because that's just how hard it is to open a restaurant, manage it properly, you know, make sure the finances are in order, and get people to keep coming back. Now, you can't eat indoors, you can't eat outdoors, so you can only do to go and everything else. But all the other small businesses, mom and pop stores that maybe sold sporting goods or sold some sort of electronics or everything else, the stuff that you can get in Target. Now, I have no problem with Target. I love competition, I love business, I love the fact that, you know, if you sell something that's worthwhile and you can do it at a better price than somebody else, then you're going to succeed and they're going to fail. That's what capitalism's all about. It's a beautiful thing. But the idea that we've decided to say, okay, if you're a small mom and pop store that sells sneakers, you're done. But if you're the big store that sells, then you're okay. This is a big
problem. Yeah, you're COVID safe.
This is a big problem, and it doesn't seem to be going away. And, you know, the other problem with this is, although as I said, I'm a capitalist, you know, if we only have giant corporations that can do things, that does whittle away at the American dream, because the American dream is that, oh, you can go out and build something yourself. And I have no problem with Amazon, actually, but not everybody should work at Amazon. So while they're expanding right now, it's on the backs of all the businesses that are being broken by bad policies.
Absolutely. And if you don't have the small operators, you don't have the competition, and the big players can start taking advantage of their near monopoly. Now, we played audio of Tom Cruise earlier in the program, raging at his film crew for breaching COVID restrictions. Here's a little taste.
I don't ever want to see it again. Ever. And if you don't do it, you're fired. And I see you do it again, you're gone. No apologies. You tell it to the people that are losing their homes, because our industry is shut down. We are not shutting this movie down!
Cruise apparently flew into that rage after he saw a couple of crew members standing less than a metre away from each other near a computer screen. What do you make of all that, Dave?
Well, apparently Scientology doesn't lead to inner peace. I mean, to have that much money, I mean, this guy's got to be worth something like, I don't know, $500 million. I'm just ballpark guessing. The guy's got, you know, more money than anybody. He could do whatever he wants with his life. You know, and it's like to be that angry. It's not just, oh, okay, a couple people that, by the way, you know, don't make a lot of money, that their jobs aren't nearly as secure as his. They're just trying to live. And it's like, man, to that level of anger, if you're walking around with that level of anger at that level of celebrity, at that level of fame, at that level of fortune, you may want to rethink things, man.
Yeah, I'm starting to kind of see things from Nicole Kidman's perspective. As you know, our Nicole was one of the, I think, three exactly. or four women who have been married to Tom Cruise over the years. Now, you yeah. as a married gay man, you must just be feeling absolutely joyous about the coming Biden administration having what the media are calling the first openly gay cabinet member. What do you think about that? Are you just overjoyed and celebrating in the streets?
Rita, I know you and I know you know me, so I think you know my feelings on this. I mean, first off, let's just be very clear. The media is this is complete fake news that he is the first openly gay cabinet position in an administration. Rick Grenell, who is a friend of mine, who was the former ambassador to Germany and then the acting Secretary of Intelligence, he was the first openly gay cabinet member. That's number one.
Yes.
But putting that aside, Pete Buttigieg was the mayor of South Bend, Indiana. It's a small city with about 100,000 people. He knows nothing about transportation. You know a little bit of something as the mayor, but he is not qualified in any way. And the way it's being sold on us is, oh, he's gay. He's gay, so it's wonderful.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. He's gay. What else do you want from us? And it's like, you know what? The fact that I'm gay is probably the least interesting thing about me and sort of irrelevant in the grand scheme of things. But this is the perverse thing that identity politics does. I am much more interested in quality and qualifications than I am in sexuality and diversity. But they've basically decided, oh, as long as we got a black woman here and we got a gay guy here and a trans person over here and maybe a guy with a limp and a lady with a lazy eye over here, well, then somehow we're doing something right. And you're not going to believe this, Rita. I am a fan of that guy. You may remember him, Martin Luther King Jr., and he wanted something that now is thought of as rather radical. He wanted his children not to be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. And that is literally the reverse of what the Biden cabinet is doing.
Well, it is. That's a radical position now. It's, in fact, a racist position in the eyes of many people who are obsessed with identity politics. Now, Biden has been presented as the sensible centrist, you know, very different to the Democrats, socialist squad and all the lunatics who've infiltrated the party. But he has also wholeheartedly embraced identity politics and really radical ideas like supporting children under 10 transitioning. So how much of a centrist is Joe Biden in 2020?
Well, I don't think Joe Biden knows what he is in 2020, and that really is the danger. Joe Biden is 78 years old. It's fairly obvious to everyone that he has a significant level of cognitive decline. He has trouble reading off a teleprompter, and when he's not on the teleprompter, he muddles his words. He can't really speak. He loses his train of thought and the rest of it. I don't know what they did during the debates to keep him on point, but they definitely did something. I don't know if it was from hiding in the bunker for a week beforehand, and then they just threw him out there, and he did his thing. But the idea, I heard a lot of this from my more centrist friends that were generally thought of as lefties or liberals. A lot of them said, see, the Democrats didn't go completely bananas. They didn't choose Bernie Sanders. They didn't choose Elizabeth Warren. They went with the old Joe Biden, and he's going to, you know, govern basically as a centrist Democrat. Except it's very obvious in the 30-plus days since he was elected, which I'm still not quite sure he's going to be the president even, but it's become very obvious in these 30 days with the picks, with the messaging coming out, that he is going to govern as a radical leftist. They are going to get critical race theory back in the schools. They are going to be teaching the 1619 Project. They are going to get rid of Title. They're going to put Title IX back in the colleges, which will remove due process. All of the things that, you know, were thought of as scary Trump things that in many ways were saving liberalism, saving our institutions, they're all on their way to being destroyed with the Biden administration. And I don't think he's in charge. I don't know who's in charge. But if you're walking around thinking that this 78-year-old guy with a broken foot who's, you know, can't really speak, who's coughing constantly, if you think he's in charge, I got a bridge to sell you.
I'm still bewildered by how he broke his foot. The official story seems to be now that he got out of the shower and chased his dog's... No, he got out of the shower and tried to pull his dog's tail and fell. I mean, that is just not... Who does that? Oh, goodness. But do you think we are going to have a Madam President Kamala Harris in our future? Maybe in the near future?
Yeah, well, look, going on the assumption that Biden does get sworn in on the 20th, which, again, I'm not totally sure is going to happen, but let's just say that that happens, and that's sort of conventional wisdom at this point, I would be shocked if the guy lasts a year. I would bet almost everything he doesn't last the full term, and they knew that. They knew that going in. And what I always said about this for the last year is that the scandal was the non-scandal. Everyone knows something's not right with Joe Biden. Everyone knows it. I don't take any great pleasure in that. My grandmother had dementia in her later years, and I spent a lot of time with her, and it's not fun. It's pretty horrific. So I don't mean to be glib about it. But the scandal is that the media decided we can't talk about it, while everyone knows something is wrong. So if you take his age, if you take the broken foot, if you take the fact that he's giving speeches and coughing in his hand constantly, which we're told not to do, and all of those things, and the fact that before the election, let's not forget, Nancy Pelosi, the leader of the House, was talking about using the 25th Amendment, which would basically be their way of smuggling Kamala Harris in. I think it's fairly obvious that if Biden begins the term January 20th, 2021, it will be Kamala Harris by the end of it.
And Kamala's voting record is amongst the most radically left-wing of anybody. So you go from a supposed centrist in Biden to a very different presidency if it's under Harris. Now, in 2020,
and
we saw
Rita,
BLM's...
Rita, quickly, by the way, Rita, by the way, Kamala Harris dropped out of the Democratic presidential primary very early on, even though people thought she was going to be a frontrunner, and she was basically polling at zero. So, in effect, if what we're talking about here happens, the president of the United States will be someone who dropped out of their own primary early and then polled at zero. I mean, really think about how twisted that could become.
Oh, absolutely. And she had such glowing media coverage. And, yeah, you're right. She just did horribly and got absolutely destroyed by Tulsi, who would have been a good vice president. But I digress. Now, we've seen in 2020 the influence of Black Lives Matter really increase. The corporate support for the group has soared to new heights. What has that done for race relations in the U.S.?
You know, the real truth of it is if you remove this small sliver of people who are constantly in the race trade, who are grifting on race, the average American, no matter what you're seeing on TV, Americans love the idea that we're this great pluralistic society. America has done a better job than any country in the history of the world for roughly 250 years, bringing people from all walks of life together. You can bring your foods, your traditions, your religions, all of the stuff that makes you you. And then what you do is you fold that into America. That's why we're a melting pot, which in many ways most of Europe wasn't able to do. Europe in many ways is much more ghettoized between ethnic communities. We've done it so brilliantly here, so spectacularly, and we fought a war to end slavery within about 100 years of our founding. That's pretty good. It doesn't mean our history is perfect, but it means that it's pretty good. The only racists in America today are not what the media will tell you, which is that there's these far-right racists running around in the KKK and the Ku Klux Klan. Nobody knows where they are. That's not saying that there are literally none of them. Of course, there are some actual racists. But the racists of today are the people who purport to be the anti-racists, the people who are obsessed with skin color, the people who say, oh, you should get this job because of your skin color, you should get this job because of your gender or your sexuality. So in terms of race relations in reality, the average person is not racist, and we're a highly functional, good society. There is a sliver of very influential radical leftists who have somehow infected the academic level, meaning the colleges. They've affected the political level, meaning virtually all of the Democratic Party. And then they've really affected our mainstream media, which is just an absolute clown show. And they push this idea on us, but most people are not racist. By the way, most people in your country aren't racist either. And it was one of my favorite places to visit when I was on tour. Yeah.
But we've got the same phenomenon with elements of the media and certainly academia and popular culture who are desperate to present Australia as inherently racist. Lastly, Dave, you were one of the very first people to recognise the dangers of big tech suppressing and censoring stories, people and even ideas they don't like. Will the likes of Google, Twitter and Facebook face a reckoning at some point in the future?
Well, look, David beat Goliath, so, you know, I always say maybe Dave here can beat Google. I always think there's a chance. However, again, if we're to believe that Biden is going to be sworn in come January, I think at that point, big tech is going to do things that we can't even imagine. The levels of censorship, if, you know, you've been talking about this for a long time too, Rita, and the levels of censorship that we've seen on Twitter, that we see on YouTube, algorithmic tricks, deboosting, shadow banning, the litany of ways that they manipulate us. Just as we're talking today, I just saw in the last hour, you know, 2 weeks before the election, Twitter changed the way you can retweet, which made it harder to amplify certain messages. They did that 2 weeks before the election. They didn't announce that they were doing it. They just said, okay, here we go, we're doing it. And then today they reversed it. Well, what could have happened in the last month that maybe would make them do something strange to manipulate information, and now it's okay? So I think that the only thing that was keeping them slightly in check was Trump, was the idea that, oh, he might actually move on some executive actions and do some stuff with Section 230 of the Communications Act and a bunch of other stuff. But in effect, if they have their guy in office, Biden, at that point, why wouldn't Twitter get rid of the scary Republicans, the right-wingers, the anti-lockdown people, of which I absolutely include myself? I mean, why wouldn't you just eliminate all of the people you deem bad? And I think we're in for a world of hurt after January 20th if Biden is put in.
Goodness me, that's some scary stuff. Dave Rubin, thank you so much for joining us on Inside the News.
My pleasure, Rita.